time now for the good stuff. This is beyond good. Yeah, there were some good football games this weekend, including Alabama's win in four overtimes and Michigan's historic win against rival Ohio State. But perhaps no game as meaningful and special as the one that Nick Watt went to in California. And Nick joins us now. Nick, this is just a lovely story.
It is, John. I mean, this is a team entirely made up of deaf students, their coaching staff, entirely deaf. And this was the finale to really what has already been an extraordinary season for these guys. This was the championship game of the Southern California High School Eight-Man Football League. Eight-man because these schools are small. This school is the California School for the Deaf in Riverside, and the team is the Cubs.
The Cubs, in their school's 68-year history, have never, ever, not even once, made it to a championship game. And here they are. Their opponents, Faith Baptist, have won this Southern California championship about a dozen times in their history. They're good. Damn good. Tickets for this blockbuster game sold out in 45 minutes. They had to move it to a nearby high school, bigger bleachers to seat the growing fan base. Many of them are standing, a lot.
But today is the biggest crowd I've ever seen. It is just because you have not only people that come to this school, but you have other deaf people that come from different schools. Because whenever there's a deaf event, people just want to be there.
Now, we caught up with the Cubs for the midweek team talk.
Great job. Big
and practice. The voice you'll hear is a sign language interpreter.
So we're making history here. And if we do lose, I'm still incredibly proud of this team. If we win the championship game, that would just be that much more awesome.
Here is the already awesome backstory. The CSDR Cubs, in the past, lost a lot.
The team stunk, quite honestly. CSDR were often viewed as kind of the laughing stock, right? We're always going to have these lousy seasons, but that has not been the case this season.
First game, a 68-0 victory. Yeah, that's a six. This is not a well-funded fancy pants program.
Why are you guys doing so well? What's the secret?
We've practiced strong. We've worked together. We've got this sense of brotherhood amongst us. We're a family.
Next up, a drubbing, then a shellacking. Their season so far, 12-0.
You're not just a good deaf football team, you're a good football team.
Exactly right, exactly right. We've played against other good teams, let me say, but we just keep beating them.
Back at the championship game, second quarter, the Cubs are down 28-0. Oh boy.
Typically for our games, we are winning by a pretty, 20, 30 point margin by halftime. And this is definitely a very different vibe.
And then a hook and ladder play sparks a startling rally. Suddenly, it's 28-22. The crowd's going nuts. But how do the players feed off that? With their eyes.
During your breaks, during halftime, you look around, they're cheering, their hands are waving in the air, you see their energy, and that's just, that feels so good.
The Cubs' average winning margin this season, nearly 50 points.
Have you yourself scored any touchdowns this year?
More than 15? I lost count.
Nice.
These kids were already confident. They didn't need this historic run to prove their worth in the world, but some opponents underestimated them badly.
I think they do dismiss us oftentimes. They think we're a deaf school, no big deal. And I think it's a lesson learned for them that deaf people out there and other programs can do better than they are doing.
Back to that championship game. Halftime, Valencia, touchdown king, is iced. He's out. Tatum Adams is limping. He's the coach's son, by the way. and his brother, starting quarterback Trevin, takes a hit. His night is over. The limping Caden has to take his spot. Now, to most of us, a football game sounds like this. For these kids, we'll turn off the sound. That could be a disadvantage. They make it an advantage.
During the game, we're able to throw out plays, exact plays. Hearing teams don't understand what our plays are, what's being shared on the field.
Tree, that's the part of their play, is tree. Watch the ball. Watch the ball.
This is our first language. It's our native language. We're using our native language on the field. And visual acuity is more alert than your hearing opponents typically, and so that we use that as an advantage, yeah.
To go from laughingstock to media darlings, moving merch.
Now we've got TV producers, movie producers reaching out to us. It's just, it's endless. Yeah, it definitely feels like we've reached celebrity status.
I don't think the media and everything is getting to their head. They're just focused on the game.
But with two key Cubs stars sidelined, those burly Faith Baptist boys proved just too much. A second half blowout. The Cubs distraught. They weren't in this for a heartwarming story about deaf kids against the odds. They were in this to win.
And I'm very proud. They defeated us, yes, but they've taught us a lesson. That means that the expectation is going to be higher next year.
And get this, there were only two seniors on this Cubs team. Next year, maybe, just maybe.
And you saw the coaches there, clearly so proud of their team at the end, but during that little huddle, they also started talking about next season. One of the coaches says, I want you guys to be benching 200 pounds before next season begins. And the coach, the head coach there, called this just a glitch in the Cubs story. Guys.
All because of the hook and ladder. The comeback because of the hook and ladder. What a wonderful story, Nick. And also, you're such a brilliant storyteller. I just hope that they have taken a moment to be proud of themselves for what they accomplished.
I'm sure they will. But listen, you know, as I said at the end of that story, they weren't in this for the heartwarming story. They were in this as football players to win. The fact that they were deaf, the fact that they are deaf is just an aside. And there's another really interesting thing one of the parents told me after the game. She said, you know, we heard Enos, one of the players there, talking about the brotherhood, the family that this team's created. One of the mothers said, you know, sometimes if a child is born deaf and the parents are not deaf and the parents don't speak American Sign Language, can't do American Sign Language, then that child can feel slightly isolated. They go to a deaf school, they join a deaf football team, and that then really does become so much more of a family because they can communicate so freely with each other as you and I do through speaking because we are hearing people. I mean, this was beautiful. The school was inspired, the community was inspired. As one of the mothers said, deaf people were coming from other schools around the state, even from out of state, to watch this game. It meant so much for them as deaf footballers, but also as footballers. Guys?
Look, and Nick, in any other state, this would be a state championship game, right? Because California is just so huge. This may be the southern section, but this is representing such a vast area. It's a huge accomplishment.
Totally. In fact, there was some talk of that after the game. We were like, listen, I mean, this is still huge. I mean, this is Southern California, but yeah, California has 40 million people. I mean, and again, remember, in 68 years, they've never even made it to the championship game. Now, the coach said at the start of the season, he knew that this was a good bunch of players. He didn't know quite how good they were. And it is extraordinary also that there were only two seniors on the team. Jory Valencia, one of the stars there, who we saw scoring a touchdown, he's a sophomore. He's 6'2" already. And, you know, it was interesting when the game started and we saw the Faith Baptist team come on, you could see, I mean, they were big, I would imagine. I don't know. I'm not casting any aspersions, but a lot of them were seniors. So this team that has played together a lot, you know, for many years as they've come up through the grades, you know, next year they really hope that they can take it all the way. And I don't know. I mean, I certainly would not bet against them.
Sign me up for season tickets. I want to be there for this. What a wonderful story. The part that got me was when they described looking into the crowd and seeing everyone cheering with their arms raised and how much that meant. So that's what we're doing now, Nick. We're standing up and cheering for them so they can see it. Thank you so much for that wonderful story.